Well, hello. I'm back. First of all, thank you very, very much for your comments on the last. I think we can make this work. So, yeah, re really appreciate that, more than you guys can ever imagine. And yeah, let's do something cool, shall we? I've been working on a bit of a project. Doing some design pattern-y type thing for implementing an interface to a hardware peripheral. In this case, I've just sort of picked a UART as an example. And most chips that I use at least have more than one UART on them. For example, the ESP has or at least the 32 has got a couple on there, and you can also sort of bit bang a software UART as well on additional pins if you wish, rather than using the hardware UART. And these are all, of course, provided in C, which is fine. We're not here to C bash, but this is a C++ channel. So how can we implement this in the C way and avoid, where at all possible, any runtime allocations? So I want this to be as static in terms of memory as possible. So that's the plan. Now, I've had a couple of people asking about my VS Code setup, so let's do that first. If someone would be so kind as to put a timestamp down below in the comments to for the end of the VS Code setup stuff and where we actually start hitting the keyboard, I would be extremely grateful. So anyone who doesn't really care about the IDE side of things can just skip forwards. So let's do it and let's see if this button works. Oh, look at that, professional. I joke. That's not what I wanted to do. I wanted to do F11. Right, okay, so I am in the way. Look at that, I'm a fast boy. So I've just opened up VS Code. I've actually opened up two instances because over here I have my notes, but let's not spoil. So when I opened up this instance, it's not tied to a workspace, it's pretty much vanilla. Apart from the things, the extensions I have installed, loosely speaking, anyway. So you can obviously pause the video, but I'm just going to quickly scroll through these now, so you can do your pausey thing, and then what we'll do is we'll just quickly skim through the key ones, just so you sort of have an idea why I've got them. Some of them are trivial, some of them are probably not going to be around much longer if they annoy me too much. Better comments, absolutely love this one. This is a 10 out of 10 for me. You can see what it does here. You know what? I need to change my zoom level so you guys have a fighting chance of seeing what's going on. Should have done that before. My apologies, folks. I hope that's a little bit better. But what you can see here is, even in the sort of doc string, as it were, but also in code comments down here, you can put little tokens, is probably the right word, after your double forward slash. And all it does is it changes the color that the comment shows as. So here, normal comment, and of course it works with the disgusting slash star or slash asterisks. Block comments, please don't do that. Why? Because block comments are very useful for debugging. If you want to just block comment out a huge chunk of code, and block comments work particularly well for that in a lot of IDEs, because you can then collapse the whole thing and then it all goes away to nothing, and doesn't use the pre-assembled preprocessor. So the other way of doing it is you just put an if naught around the whole thing and then an end if at the bottom. That also works. So, you know, choose your poison at the end of the day. But if you've got block comments everywhere, you can't put another block comment around that. So then you've straight away limited your options. So personally, I don't like block comments. Just put a slash slash at the start of each line. It does exactly the same thing. But you can still block comment when you're debugging. Anyway, tangent over. Normal comment, so in this case slash star, or this could be a slash slash here, does the same thing. Gives you your normal comment in this case in green. I believe all the colours are actually configurable. If you do a slash slash and then an exclamation mark, as it's shown here, so that's the sort of syntax, it makes it red. Question mark, blue, blah blah blah, you can see. To be honest, the only one I really use is to do and fix me as well. Fix me is quite a good one. And this sort of works quite nicely with another mod of similar vein. You probably don't need both, actually. Well, actually, no, let's take that back. So to-do tree passes comments that start slash slash space to-do space then your comment, which you can sort of see here if you really squint your eyes, but I don't believe I can zoom on that. No, it's not letting me do it. But you'll see this in the code in due course anyway. In fact, I'll tell you what, I can probably... No, because I'm not even in a repo and I don't want to mess everything up. We'll see this in action. It highlights nicely the to-do word and so on. But it also gives you a nice little tab over in your sidebar here where you can search through the entire project by file, if you wish, for all your slash slash to-dos. Now, the to-do word is not particularly special. That is just one of the defaults. Fix me is another one. So you can add your own sort of layer of urgency into this, and you can add whatever token you wish as well. So you know, if you've got special things, if you're working in a team, you know, I might want to do slash slash Simon, so then I can see all the notes that I have for me, but the other guys, you know, they can just in the sidebar when they're looking through the notes, they can ignore the ones that I've already picked up or the ones that I've made, because I've made it as a note for me. And if you squint, or if you're on a PC, you can probably just see how that is presented in the sidebar as well, giving you all the to-dos and the fix-me's and everything. Really useful. And I find it works nice with better comments, because the better comments highlights the entire line, changes colours and so on. And then the to-do notes gives you a nice sidebar list of all those throughout your project. Bookmarks pretty much does exactly what it says on the tin. Imagine putting a breakpoint in your code. Well, rather than a breakpoint, which is a debugging tool, you can put a bookmark. It's just a completely arbitrary thing, doesn't affect the file in any way. But then it gives you in your sidebar a list of all your bookmarks. So if there's, you know, places that you're constantly flicking to, you know, certain places in code in a particular file, and you want that as a quick access, like a bookmark would be on Chrome or Firefox or whatever, it's exactly the same thing. So rather than having a million tabs open, you can just have a few bookmarks, open it when you want it, and then close it. That works quite nicely. CodeTour, that's something I want to start using. It turns your code, it allows you to record, I believe, a tour around your code, for want of a better word. I've not used it yet, so I won't talk about this too much. A couple of themes, community material theme, quite like this. I can't remember which one I'm using at the moment. Will it tell me which one I am currently on? Oh my god, I didn't realise it was going to change this as I went through. I am very sorry if you're watching this at night in a dark room and it's just done all of that in your face. I can't remember what I'm on. I thought it would say the one I'm actually currently on. Oh, Jesus. Is it in the... Ah, yes, here we go. Community material theme darker. That's the one I use. So to the person who asked me which theme I used in a couple of videos ago, that is the one I use. And as far as I'm aware, in fact, I'm pretty certain I have not overridden anything. It's all default. I was hoping there'd be a nice pretty picture of this, but there isn't. Discord presence, then. That's just a gimmick. If you know what Discord is, it can read, like the old MSN days actually, where in your sort of below your name, in your, well, your status would be, it can pick up which game you are playing. And what this does is rather than obviously VS Code being a game, but it allows Discord to detect, or actually works the other way around, but anyway, that you are using VS Code. So it says next to your name that you are using VS Code, which I find is quite funny. Let's see if I can actually show you that in action. Might not work, so I'm not in a workspace. Oh no, it says it's down here, look. Let's see if I can do this without doxing anyone. And can I? Yes, I can. So let's see how I can do this. I can probably do it like that. I don't know why I'm trying so hard for this, but you can see here, Green Giant, that's me, and it says playing Visual Studio Code, which I think is quite funny. Again, doesn't really achieve anything. Excel viewer file utils, these, yeah, sort of say what they do, to be honest. File utils are sort of sidebar enhancements, changing the icons and things. It's not useful. It's purely aesthetic. Excuse me. And aesthetics can be useful, so I'm not poo-pooing it. Gists are quite useful if you use GitHub gists. I do particularly like them. And these two sort of allow you to sort of browse through the gists you've got, create new ones. It just syncs up nicely to GitHub. Pretty much all these Git ones are just really, really handy to have if you use Git. Git history as well. You can see, without needing to do command line stuff or another application, you can see previous versions of the code or what the line, that particular line was in the last commit or the last change, so on. Project manager, again, it just gives you better integration into VS Code if you're a Git person. Pull request, not really used this. This has changed its name recently. I forget what the old name was. So yeah, I've not really used this in aggression yet, but we'll see how it goes. Git Lens is really good. I love Git Lens. So what Git Lens does, if I just drag this over here, is, can you see this text here? Simon Harrod, that's me, 2 days ago, initial commit. That's the last time this line where my cursor is changed. And if I hover over that, we can see a bit more. You can see the full commit message, which that's a particularly bad example. Yeah, let's do that one because this probably has a bit more in it. You can see what was added, what was subtracted. In this case, nothing was subtracted. These are all hyperlinks as well, so you can go to that commit. It's just absolutely blooming brilliant. Really, really good, particularly if you break something, and that's a line that broke, rather than opening up a browser and finding it and then trying to find the file, blah, blah, blah. You've got it straight in here. You can hover over there and click on the commit, and then you can open that. So let's sort of see. If I can remember how to do this, Yeah, there we go. That's what I wanted to do. And you get your side by side, what changed. This is probably not the best example because I think this was a new file. But you can see what got added, what got changed. Oh yeah, all it was is I removed this space there. And you can see that was the end. Anyway, Git stuff, very, very handy if you're a Git person, which I highly recommend. Hex editor, I only added this yesterday actually for reading binary files. I forget the one I used to use was a Windows application, Hercules I think it was. I must say I'm not a huge fan of this so far, but actually no, I take that back, sorry, I'm getting confused with something else. No, I like this. We'll see what I don't like when we get into the code. IntelliCode, I don't think supports C++ yet. I was checking this out yesterday, so that's probably dead. Material icon theme just provides icons for file types in your sidebar when we get there. So you can see sidebar here, we get a nice sort of Git logo, H is for header files, license is like a little key, I guess that is. It's a binary file, you can just sort of hopefully just see it's a file with zeros and ones in it, and that sort of stuff. It's nice. Makes things look pretty, and I know that is not the most important thing in the world, but actually you see pictures very quickly, much quicker than you read words. So if it just helps you at a glance find your file, you shave off 100 milliseconds from your search over the course of the year. That probably adds up, but whatever, it makes your life a bit nicer. Material theme, I don't think I'm using that, because I think I'm using the other one, aren't I? Yeah, I'm using the community material theme, so that one's fairly dead. Output colorizer. I think this is for terminal stuff, if I remember rightly. Yeah, output debug extensions panel. Oh, and log files. Oh, I didn't realise it did that. That's handy. So there you go. Project dashboard. To be honest, I don't use that. Project manager I do use. This is basically just an inbuilt, like you have in pretty much every other IDE, you know, Eclipse if you're familiar with that, or all the, you know, all the other ones. Just allows you to switch between projects in your sidebar. It's probably not going to show any here because I'm not in a repo yet. In fact, that's Git, so that's completely irrelevant. But yes, this is very, very good when you're flicking between things. In fact, I wonder if I can show it. No, I haven't got it set up on this machine. I've got it set up on my laptop. Are we still on enabled? Yeah, Python. I have this enabled globally just because it's really handy to have sometimes. But probably shouldn't be. Likewise for remote SSH. That's handy if I'm working with code that I've got saved on my NAS rather than on my local machine here. It allows you to basically remote work. I only really do that locally, so between here and my NAS drive. But it's SSH, you can connect anywhere in the world with that. So it might be handy for work. Restructured text, I've completely forgotten what it does, but I had it for a reason. Is this Markdown? Might be Markdown stuff. I forget. But anyway, I don't remember. Huh. No, I forget. Smooth type, it's just a visual thing. I assume it makes types look smoother. Oh, okay, right. It just adds a bit of slowness. Fine, whatever. To-do tree, we've talked about that one already. And VS Code icons, I don't think I've got that one enabled. But it's another icon package. Okay, so that is what I've got installed and enabled by default whenever I start a new project. So these are all globally enabled. So what I want to do is let's start a new project. Let's go there, and let's do YouTube. YouTube does not exist because I'm a dum-dum. Let's make a YouTube select folder Bosch. This is going to do a reload and a flickety flick. Excellent. So collapse, collapse. So these are all, that's what we've just seen, right? All the ones that are globally enabled and always on. Now we're going to do a C++ project here. I'm not going to do it as embedded for this video. We'll sort of see why. But I need to add some things to make that work. So here are other packages I have installed and use, but are currently not enabled, at least not enabled globally. So stuff for 3D printing, stuff for ARM. Emoji, I don't know why I've still got that, but it's quite funny. Docstring, if I'm doing Python stuff, that's good. Bracket pair colorizer is now inbuilt into VS Code, so we don't need that. C++, we need. I don't want to enable it globally because sometimes I work on Python, so we'll enable it for this workspace. In fact, pretty much all these C++ ones I'm going to enable. And format, maybe we'll set that up. CMake, maybe we'll set that up, but it doesn't hurt to have it. Code spell checker drives me up the wall, so I'm not going to enable that. We've got the IDF, obviously, I only want to do that if I'm doing those sorts of things. Probably not going to need to touch the linker. LaTeX, don't need that. Markdown, don't need that. This one might be handy. Is this not built in? No, I think we'll just stick with GDB, which is built in. So, NRF stuff, we're not doing that. OpenHAB, pasting indent sometimes drives me up the wall. So I've got that disabled. Platform IO, I've not touched that in years. Setting syncs inbuilt, STM32 text lib YAML. Yep, okay, so I've got everything enabled, and is it wanting me to do a reboot Arino? I don't think it is. Okay, so, well, let's see what happens then. So let's make a file, hello world. .cpp. Ah, okay, there we go. So the CPP extension sort of sprung into life there. Let's do a not an import hash include iostreamstram. Sorry, iostream. Let's speak properly. This keyboard is so clacky. I'm very, very sorry. Int main using standard dout. Hello world. F5. Right, okay, so how are we going to run this? GDB is what I prefer. So we'll click GDB, and here we can see the list of compilers I've got installed on this Windows machine. VS Code, well, specifically the C++ extension has detected these as being on the machine. So if you don't have these installed, you need to install them. So I've got Clang, and I've got G++ and so on. We're going to use G++ just because I'm a bit more familiar with that. I will be getting into Clang at some point. So we click that, It starts to build, build finished successfully, and now it's going to run it. Jesus, that was slow. And we get our nice hello world. How cool is that? Built and compiled. Done. Next video then. No, I'm joking. Now, what did that do? Well, straight away you can see in our environment here, we now have an .exe file, which is what was built. And if actually I find that, code YouTube. So if I find this in Explorer, can I zoom in on this? Holy crap, that's painful, isn't it? It's made me an .exe file. Let's double click that, see what happens. Interesting. When I tried this earlier, it brought up a command prompt that ran it. Maybe that just runs too quick. Standard this thread. Is it sleep? Sleep for 2 seconds. And we need to do a hash include chrono. And then using standard. Sorry, using namespace standard chrono literals. Hang on, let me check my notes. That's wrong. Oh, standard chrono underscore literals. I was close. And then that allows us to do 2 seconds here, which is really, really cool. So if I hit an F5 on that to recompile it. Hello world, 1, 2, returns. Right, are you going to work now? Hey, there we go. Command prompt, hello world, 1, 2, exits. I suppose what I could do is C standard def, and let's, yeah, notice this doesn't return anything. Int main is one of the very few functions you won't get a warning for. In fact, as far as I'm aware, it's the only function you won't get a warning for not specifying a return value on something that expects a return value. Let's do an exit failure, actually. Just to see if that does anything to when I run it from the command line. No, it still just terminates and buggers off. Alright, never mind. Thought that counts. But yes, you can see it's also made this VS Code folder here and made a tasks.json. Now it's important to go into this. So this is what was created when we hit F5 and selected, in my case, the compiler G++, or if we'd done Clang, it would be Clang, so on and so forth. And we can add more things to this, and that's exactly what we're going to do. So the type and everything, we don't really need to worry too much about that. Detail is, I'm going to change this to build in Windows. Really bad name, but you'll see this in a minute. And then the other things are, so this is the arguments to the compiler. The compiler being G++, and that's the path to the compiler on my machine, the absolute path. So we're building in debug mode. We're building the file that we currently have open. And then that gets converted into the output file, file dir name, which is just the root, file base name, no extension, is hello world, but without the .cpp, and then it shoves a .exe on the end of it. Now that's not good enough for me, because I want all my warnings turned on. But more, the most important thing I want is if I do hash include span, and then let's do a how can I do this nicely? So let's do a standard string. Let's do an array. So hash include array. So we'll do a stud array of const chars. Let's just arbitrarily make it 100 long at the moment, and let's call it data. Let's make a const char const pointer to some const characters. Let's just call it string because I have no imagination. Hello world. Something like that. And then we can do for size t I equals 0, I is less than what do we want? We want size of str that's really bad. Let's do it properly. Standard size. Is it standard size? Let me double check that. Standard size. Size of C or an array. Yeah, that is what I want. Oh, which header was it in? Probably utility, is it? Defined in, oh, it's defined in every header ever. Oh, interesting. Plus plus I. Plus plus I, not I plus plus. Big difference. Realistically, in this example, makes no difference, but anyway. And then we will do data I equals str I. There we go. So we're just filling the array with this. And then what we're going to do is we're going to make a function called print, and it's going to take a standard span of const characters. We'll call it view. Can't type. And then we will do you don't have to do the using if you want to type standard each time. We will do C out of the view is and then a slash n at the end of that. Why is it giving me all I know why it's giving me the squiggles, bear with me. So right now, how can we test this? So we'll do a C out. Original is we'll do for const auto and C in C in data, spot the bug. C and then C out slash N. Oh yeah. Okay, so the bug here is that's going to print 100 characters. We don't want that, so actually let's just get the... It's 12, isn't it? So highlight what I want. It's 11 plus the null terminator is 12. So let's make that the right size. So that's our original. And then we will do a print of standard span. So this will hopefully make sense in a moment. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I think I've done that right. Let's hit F5, and this should give us an error. Span is not a member of standard. So, why? Span came in C++ 20. I am using whatever version of G++ I'm on. G++ version 11.2. I think it was something like 8 or 9 C++ 20 came in. I think it was 9.4 or something. This has it. Problem is, the default is C++ 17, I believe, for this version of G++ that I'm using. So we need to tell it, and that's where this tasks file comes in, and this is where you put your flags. And if you're familiar with GCC flags, that's where it goes. So dash standard is equals C++ 20. So now if I try and build this, it's going to give me a different error because I'm an idiot. No matching. Oh, that's because I've decayed it already, which I didn't mean to do. There we go. That's how you should declare a C style string, by the way. And then you get it as an array. Is it going to give me the tooltip? I'm not getting my tooltips. Anyway, whatever. And I've made these const, which I shouldn't have done. More errors. It's supposed to be a tutorial. And requires... Let me just double check my connotes. Not that one. This is what happens when I go off piste. And that is exactly what I've done there. Almost. So let's make this a template. And make that a T. Don't think that's going to fix it, but that's what that should be anyway. No matching function called to print span. Have I been a dum-dum in how I've created my span? I think I have. Let me just pull up that file. And yes, I have. You don't need the, you don't need that. Oh, come on now. What's the issue now? Oh, just print the whole lot. Let's get it to work. Expected a semicolon. Where have I missed my semicolon? That's clearly a lie because you don't need one there. Is print a bad name? That looks like an odd error message. No, print is not an odd name. Is this a bad IntelliSense? Takes a standard span. This receives a standard span. Let's just make that T. Oh, come on. Got a feeling that error message in problems is, oh no, it's not. Interesting. I bet someone's shouting at the screen here going, you're a plonker. That's T, standard span of type T. Or type const T, doesn't matter. But I'm not modifying it, so we'll make it const. View is that. And then I call that with an array of char 10 data. That's all irrelevant. And then I construct the span with standard span. Is it not able to that's it? Well, no, of course it is, because it's detected it, so what's that? So this is detecting that's the right type. I'm going to leave this in, probably, because it's maybe useful for you guys debugging as well. Again, if someone can put a timestamp down below for anyone who doesn't want to see the debugging process and how you sort of decipher some of this nonsense. Let's just make that a bit better. There we are. No matching function for call to my print standard span. This shouldn't need this, because that should be auto detected with CTAD. Yeah, that hasn't changed anything. It's just added confusion. Let me check this. And that's correct. So where are we? Starting build. No matching functions call to stud span of const type T, which in this case is a const char. And we give it a name. Calling it with a standard span. CTAD is picking up the type. This is exactly what I've done in my notes. If you can see it, put it down in the comments. That's the only thing different between my notes and this. Just spotted one issue. Can't just print an array like that. For auto see in view. That was it. So why was it giving me... So that was an error with the insertion operator to see out, or to IOStream. Was it standard OStream? OString stream? Why was it throwing an error to the function call? How weird. Right, anyway, well, we fixed that, so now's your timestamp. Now, why is this useful to show? Excuse me. Because you can do a subspan of this. Let me just check, just find the right page in my notes. There we are. So we don't need to pass the whole array. We can pass a span, and this is cheap to copy, cheap to create, and so on. So we don't need to pass this by reference or anything. But if we just want to pass part of this, we can do a subspan. We'll start at offset 0, and we only want 5 characters. Bosh. So we just get hello. How cool is that? What if we start at offset 6 and have 5 characters? Place your bets. Should just say world. There we go. Lovely jubbly. Span is blooming brilliant. If we can get to use that, that is going to make a lot of embedded code really, really nice. You imagine from an I/O, you get a big chunk of data that's come into a buffer. Say it's a frame from a UART, an AT command or something like that, and it's got a bunch of information with it. But your buffer's bigger than that. Well, rather than copying things out of your ring buff and blah 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 to parse it and having all these copies going everywhere, you can just have a span and say, look, here's my buffer, but the only thing I am passing to the parsing functions are that convert into some sort of object is that bunch of characters. What's the equivalent? Well, the equivalent is the thing we all know, love and hate, which is this version. Let's just call it parse. And then something like that, or let's not do a void star because that's a bit ambiguous. Let's say char star, or actually whatever, it's just saying, you know, same point. You pass a pointer and a length, right, what's the problem here? Well, what if you got your length wrong? What if the pointer's null? Blah, blah, blah. It's bad. Span has more guarantees with it. Under the hood, it is effectively this is pretty much how span is defined. Template class T. T star and then that. That is pretty much how what span is in terms of its data. Of course, it's got a load of member variables and member functions. But as you can see, I mean, that is cheap as beans. It fits in two registers. So very, very easy to move around. And it couples these two things together. So you can just pass it around without, you know, risk of these getting out of sync or being wrong. Because that, and if you've worked in particularly in embedded stuff, you'll have seen this a lot, particularly in C, because that is more or less the way they do it in C. And the number of bugs you get from that is staggering. So straight away you've eliminated more or less the chance for a bug in this code. If you try and print out more characters or try and make a span more characters than the actual underlying data type, I think you get a compile time warning, error, sorry, saying you can't make a span that is bigger than the thing you're spanning. In fact, let's test that. Does that compile? Please tell me no, and I'm chatting crap. That should not have compiled as far as I'm aware. Or does it actually stop short because of the dynamic extent is wrong? The behavior is undefined if either offset or count is out of range. Oh, okay, so you can. Why is that not compile time checked? Interesting. Might have to look into why that is. Because that seems like an oversight. Strange. Anyway, there we go. So, what was all of this about? This was all about to say, look, we are now compiling in C++ 20 mode on Windows, so on and so forth. Now, I really like my compiler warning flags massively, and I would encourage you to do exactly the same. I have loads. A lot of these are taken from Jason Turner's list, which is based on the C++ core guidelines. It's not exactly the same, but it is similar. It's what I like to use for embedded when I'm allowed to. So what I'm going to do is copy these in, and then we'll sort of go through them just quickly. It's a duplicate. So there's loads here, isn't there? Pthread, that's just so I can use threads on Windows. We'll use that later into this project. WAL and WExtra, it's just turning lots and lots of different types of warnings on. Shadow is really, really useful because if I have... can I think of a good example here? Yes, let's do something like this. If some condition is true, let's just say data.size. It's just arbitrary here. And then we are going to create a new string. Called hello, or that contains hello Simon. Now, if I try and compile this, we will get a problem. Declaration of string shadows a previous local dash w shadow, and we get the squiggly things going on here, suggesting something is potentially wrong. Why? Because we have here just made a variable in this scope called str. That is within this scope, which already contains another variable called str. That is confusing. What if I want to print out that str? Well, I can't, because I've just, or at least I can't in these squiggly brackets here, because we've just shadowed it and we've just pretended that this one doesn't exist and instead use this one. That leads to lots and lots of bugs, and they're a pain and it should be avoided. So that gives you a warning when you've been a dum-dum. Non-virtual deconstructor or destructor for a class. That'll make sense when we get there if you don't already know why. Pedantic just turns on more stuff. Old style cast stops you doing something like that, a C style cast. So let's hit F5 on that. Problems, use of old style cast to an int. If you don't know why that is dangerous in C and in C++, then please do go and research it. What this can do is scary. Okay, it can cast, not only can it reinterpret cast, which can straight away lead to a seg fault or an exception, it can also cast away const, which is really bad, because this const cast string is stored in read-only memory on the chip, read-only. That means it cannot be changed. If I do string of, let's just say the fifth character equals capital X, right, this won't compile because that is const. Let's just get rid of these other bits. Okay, and let's see why it won't compile. Assignment of read-only location. That string does not exist in RAM. It is not changeable. It is read-only. Not because, you know, someone arbitrarily said it's read-only, because it is stored in flash as read-only. It is not for modification. It's stored in a different part of memory. Here I am trying to change that read-only memory. It won't work. What if I do that? Let's do auto p equals that. And it runs. And here we can even see where it's inserted it. We've just modified the program memory here. That's bad. That's really, really bad, because we've just cast away const. That on embedded, that might throw an exception. I'm actually quite surprised that that ran here. But this is really bad. If I make that const expert. So this is modifying memory it shouldn't have access to. That's really interesting. We get this warning because I've turned it on. That's really bad. You should not cast away const. Say this was, let's just do by way of example something slightly less contrived, but let's say this was from a buffer somewhere, and it's come in and we've marked it as const, so it's not to be changed. And we just want to, it's come in as a UIN8, but we actually want it as a character so we can print it as ASCII. And you might think, well, that's all fine and dandy, but you've not just cast it to a character pointer from a UIN8 pointer, you've actually cast away const, which allows you to do that and modify constant data. So two problems with that. One, you could be trying to access program memory that is read-only, and the second one is the compiler makes optimizations based on const and knowing the fact that certain things cannot change throughout the time that they are const, so it can reorder stuff and make pretty nice optimizations based on that. If you start casting away const, things break very quickly. So old style casts are bad. So let's just reset that. Cast align, that's to do with alignments. If alignment changes, you can read up on that if you want. Unused is if you've got if you've declared variables that you're not actually using. Overloaded virtual, we'll probably come to that in the future. Pedantic, wpedantic and pedantic are slightly different. I don't know why they both exist, it's confusing. Dash w conversion is for implicit conversions when you probably didn't expect them. There's a specific case of this, which is actually an up convert. So this is typically for down conversion. So if you are going from a 32-bit to a 16-bit integer, for example, this will give you a warning that you will be losing precision on that. Sign conversion, so that's if you're going from a signed variable to an unsigned variable. Again, you can lose precision on that. Normally do. Misleading indentation, so this is just a graphical thing. If I, you know, do something like this, perhaps. I wonder if that will twig a misleading indentation, or whether it's more for loops. No, that won't trigger it. That will. Or it better do. Yep, there we go. Misleading indentation on this line. Because I've indented this, it reads like this for loop does this and this. Because of the way I've indented it. That's not what actually happens because I've not got braces around this. That is what actually happens. The for loop is that statement here. Does not include the new line. So if I indented that by mistake, it looks like at a glance that all of this is the for loop, when actually it's only these two lines here. So that's a really good one to have on. Obviously, quite often you'll see coding standards that mandate you using scopes, which makes this a little bit clearer and less error prone. Uses up many more lines. It's unnecessary sometimes. This is just as fine. I don't particularly like one lines, but I do quite like this. And as long as you've got this flag turned on, then it normally gets rid of sillies where you add an extra line on here, forget that it's not scoped and so on. Right, you get a compiler warning. Excellent. Duplicated conditions, so that's if you've got an if else. And the else is the same. Same with branches, sort of similar things going on here. Logical op, so that's if I use a bitwise AND rather than a logical AND, for example, or a bitwise OR, a single pipe rather than a double pipe. It can detect whether or not that's a bug. So if you had int I and j, so you can do if I and j, then do something. That's nearly always a bug. What you meant to do was that, double ampersand, so, or if you prefer, and, rather than a bitwise and, which is typically a bit mask. Maybe not the best example, but you're probably not bit masking signed integers there, at least. That's a really good one. I quite like that. It's caught a few bugs. Null dereference is really, really good. It's a very low level or very immature, minor way of doing a bit of static analysis. It doesn't go the full hog, it's not perfect, but it can catch some obvious typos or bugs, where you construct a pointer, for example, and it's null, and the compiler can detect that it is null, and then you try and dereference it. You will get a compiler warning for that, with this flag turned on, which is good. Useless cast. So if we try to do so int I, and then we did j equals, let's do it properly, static cast int I. Oops. And compile that, we will get a warning. Useless cast to type int. It's probably not the biggest bug in the world, or even not a problem, but it does show that there was a lack of thought went into this line of code, and you were probably tired and so on. So maybe we need to review this, because if you're casting something to what it already is, clearly you're not thinking straight. So having a warning about that is quite useful. Here we see the unused variable warning as well. Double promotion, that's a killer on embedded. Well, I say killer, can be a big killer on embedded. Lots of things that use floating point automatically, in terms of functions and so on, particularly standard library, automatically promote things to double precision. Now, depending on your particular implementation of your compiler, for the chip you're using and so on, you'll quite often find actually an embedded that a double is 32 bit and a float is 32 bit. So the types are identical in all but name. So it's not normally a problem, but sometimes, and I've come across it before, a double is defined as double precision, which is 64 bit normally. Is there a 16 bit float? Not see. I know they have existed, but I've not seen one for a long time. But a 64-bit float, so a double as it would be on most desktop stuff, is a huge, slow thing to chuck through your floating point unit on your microprocessor, and that will grind stuff to a halt. And you're thinking, well, I'm working in 32-bit. I'm only using floats, which are faster, not fast, but much faster than doubles. But because you're passing it to a function and it is promoting it to a double without you knowing, which is perfectly fine, you can upscale an int 8 to an int 32. That is not a warning. It is perfectly fine in the language and normally does not cause any performance issue, any noticeable performance issue. Sometimes you actually get a bonus. This one will never give you a bonus on when you've got a 32-bit floating point unit on your chip. So that one's quite useful. Formats 2, I forget what that does. You know what, let's look it up. Dash W format. Okay, yeah, so it's for like printf and so on, where you are doing a string formatting. So if you're doing so you want to print out a string and you give it an integer. Will this compile or do I need to add the header? Oh, have I just got a really nice... Oh, I got a seg fault. Nice. Oh, yeah, there we go. Dash W format. Argument 2 has type int. So it expected a char star because %s, and I gave it an int. Oh, yeah. And it's because it's expecting that to be null terminated. It wasn't. So... problem with C strings is it just ran off the end of the stack, which is quite amusing, which is why I got the seg fault. So there we go. That's my setup. So this is in Windows. Can I? Nope. There we go. So that's in Windows. Now, I do have this running on my laptop as well, which is in Ubuntu, and what you can do quite nicely here, if you do want to sort of switch between two different machines or two different compilers, so this is using G++ here, is you can add another configuration. So stick a comma at the end of your JSON here, so that was it. Maybe give it a different name. And here you can see that's clearly a Linux string, a Linux path, should I say. Got exactly the same setup. I'll explain that one in a minute. Differences, and the thing you need to change is this is default to false, particularly if you're syncing code. So by default it's true. I set that to false. Now when I F5 this, oh, it's still running. And I F5 this, it'll now give me the option. So remember when I typed in building Windows as the description? There we go. And this is the other one I've just appended to the bottom of that config for Linux. That's not going to work, obviously. So I just click that. Now if you don't sync your tasks.json between the two machines, then of course you can set this to true on one machine and false to the other. There may be a way of auto detecting it. I'm not sure how to do that. If anyone knows down below, would be very helpful. The one thing left to talk about on here is clearly we are just compiling the file we're in, this .cpp file. What if we have more than one CPP file? We need to compile all of them, link them together, and so on. You could just list them all by name here, or you can do it the slightly more, I would say, intelligent way, which is we know the path to this folder that we're in, because it's there, it's file dir name, and then we can use a wildcard, well, /, first of all, to get us into that folder, and then we can do *.cpp, and then anything with the extension .cpp in here will get compiled now. That's simple as that. And we can just prove that's still working, and away we go. Okay. What are we on? An hour. You know what? I'm going to split this up. So that is set up of VS Code. All right. Yeah, let's split this into two videos. Sorry, folks, for those who have done, if you've done a timestamp, I appreciate you so much. But let's split this into two videos and do the coding on the next one for the actual UART stuff we're going to look at. So let's do that. Yeah, makes sense. I'll put these videos up back to back though, assuming I get the next one. I'm just going to record it straight now, straight away. After I've been to the loo anyway. Any questions, as usual, down below. If I missed something or skimmed over something you're not sure of in this setup, then let me know. Happy to come back or just answer in the comments, whatever. Do more video, so on and so forth. But see you shortly.